51 on Saturday.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. And I'm happy to say that I have paid my mortgage, ever since I was in, my early 20s, strictly just being involved with music. And I'm very grateful to that. And having said that, I will say that there have been many detours along my path that had you asked me when I was your age, some of the things that I ended up doing, I would have told you that you were crazy. But thankfully, my path, just like your path, is going to be unique, and you'll have a lot of different detours along the way, and that's part of this. You know, that's part of this is having is being adaptable. So let me just give you. I know a lot of you don't really know who I am, so I'm just give you a little background about me. I'm originally from Atlanta, Georgia, like Alexander here, and who picked me up today, and grew up there, and ended up going to school at a place called the University of North Texas. Has a big jazz studies program there, and when I graduated from there, I was recruited, thankfully, by a great jazz trumpet player named Maynard Ferguson, and toured with his big band. That was my first time to go all over the world. After I left his band, I moved to New York City, which is where I always thought that I wanted to be. Until I lived there. And this is where the first big detour happened. So when I got up there, I actually went to do I was really interested in production, and I'd been encouraged by a great producer that I'd worked for in Dallas. When I moved to New York to get an internship at a recording studio, which is what I did. I worked at Battery Studios, and that's where the first D'Angelo record was recorded. That's where, Tribe Called Quest, all their stuff was done, and they were all around. I didn't know very many of those folks when I was there. I didn't know who Q-Tip was. My involvement with the D'Angelo record was entailed going and getting the honey that comes in the little bear for him. That's a true story. I had to go back and get the special honey for him. And so as an intern there, I was actually away from the music. I wasn't really in the sessions and stuff like that. About that same time, I got an opportunity to do a show, like a Broadway show, but it was called the Big Apple Circus. And that's something else I didn't think I was going to be doing. But it was an incredible gig. The band was amazing players. And I started doing that because I could make a lot more money doing that show. But saying that, it was a show. And it was the same show 11 times a week. I played that same show 11 times a week. That repetition just about drove me nuts. And I thought, wow, here's some of these people that are heroes of mine, musicians, and this is, they're playing the show because it was good money, at the time. But I realized, man, maybe that my, this is not necessarily what I want to be doing. And so I thought, well, do I really want to stay in New York? At that time, some people that I moved to school with, part of my crew in North Texas had moved to Nashville. And so they were all saying, Jim, you got to move down to Nashville. I don't know if you guys may know Jeff Coffin, who's a great tenor saxophone player. He plays with Dave Matthews Band. They all played for a long time. He was one of those guys. He's like, Jim, you got to come down, move to Nashville. So I moved down there. I went down there to visit and sub on some gigs. One of the musicians that I was playing with says, hey, are you living in Nashville now? And I said, well, I'm thinking about moving here, He said, well, I'm working with a singer named Crystal Gale, and she needs a drummer. Would you be available? Do you want to come audition for the gig? I said, well, sure. I didn't know much about her music, I certainly didn't know anything about country music or crossover music like her music. I went auditioned for her gig, and then all of a sudden, you know, it was like a really great, you know, road gig. And so I ended up moving to Nashville, and that was back in 1995. And stayed there, and it was a great gig to have, because I was able to slowly start integrating into doing a lot of recording in Nashville, playing a lot of recording sessions. And then the kind of the next detour that happened is I, you know, had left her band and then ended up, you know, a job came open at the University of Northern Colorado. Some guys encouraged me to apply for it. And the next thing I know, I'm you know, teaching at a college, you know, in a jazz studies program, which was great. I was able to keep my home in Tennessee, bought a house out in Colorado, and then would just commute back and forth and still work in Tennessee. I had all my gear still back there, everything made it easy to do. And then continued to tour and play there. I started working with a great singer named Allison Krauss in about 2007, and toured with her and her band Union Station on and off till about 2011. And then continued to work there, continued to teach. And then 2 years ago, kind of the next big life change was my wife and I have a little boy. His name's Oliver, he's two now, and he's like my great joy. And so I'm still involved in Nashville quite a bit. I sold my home there when my son was born. Property's going up like crazy there, just like it is here and every other place. So, but I still am producing some projects there now and still recording. And so, you know, Jenna had mentioned to me talking a little bit about what exactly goes on at a typical session, because there's a lot of stuff that happens that I didn't really know as a drummer. Do we have some drummers in here? Okay. And so this would be kind of, you know, specifically geared toward you, but it really it kind of goes for everybody. I'll tell you, one of the things that I really love about Nashville is there still seems to be a lot of value in capturing a performance, okay? So Nashville is one of the, you know, few towns left where they like to get all the band all in the same room and record everybody together, you know? So this is a tradition that goes way, way back, you know, of course, when we didn't have the recording technology that we all have today. But that is really great because you can, you know, as a producer, you're trying to get kind of the best possible performance out of everybody. To have everybody reacting and responding to one another through listening to each other is really how, in my opinion, you're going to get the best music, you know. So even if something has to get fixed or a vocalist has to replace their part or even redo their part, at least being there and being able to sing it so that the other musicians know exactly what's going to happen, the dynamics of the track or whatever, is really, really important. So let's just talk about kind of what happens. First of all, I want you to stop me at any point. So if you guys have any questions, you know, please ask. I hear you like to ask a lot of questions, so that's great. Yes?
What are some of the studios that you mainly record at in Nashville?
There's a lot of them have a lot of the bigger ones have closed, but Masterphonics, Soundstage is another one, Wildwood, Prime Recording, Blackbird is another one. Yes?
Do you feel like college prepared you or not prepared you for a touring musician and a session musician?
I think my experience in college, I think it really did a lot of things to help prepare me for that. You know, because it helped me develop a lot of skills that were going to be important. And those skills would be reading music, no matter if it's reading notated notated page, or, you know, I've got some other examples of some different types of charts that, you know, like learning the Nashville number system, I didn't learn really until I got to Nashville, you know. But I feel like that the way that I had, you know, had learned about music theory and all of that stuff was really, really important to being able to sort of adapt to the Nashville number system. So I feel like that the reading aspect, and reading is really important. It's really important. I'd like to tell you that it's not. I mean, reading is just the syntax, you know. It's a way that we can communicate quickly, you know, that I can say, well, this is the form of the tune and these are the chord changes, you know. It's a way that we can communicate our ideas really, really quickly. So if you're able to write a really good, clear chart, then in the shortest amount of time, you're going to get exactly what you want from the group. And what's that going to do? That's ultimately going to save you money or somebody else money. And that's always a good thing. So the reading is really important. Another thing that really helped me develop in college was my ability to listen, the ability to use my ears and listen to the other musicians that I was playing with. Because I didn't really realize that a lot of the times when I was playing music with other musicians, that I was really more focused on myself than anybody else that was there. And now it's the exact opposite. Like, you know, if I'm playing with other people, I am hearing what everybody else is doing. You know, I want to hear, you know, to the point of looking and watching them, you know, making sure, like, you know, watching the bass player, you know, being in, you know, having a visual contact as well. So college really, really helped me with that. It also helped expose me to different styles of music that I was unfamiliar with and the great players that are associated with that style of music. So I grew up listening to rock and roll music. I was, you know, still am a Led Zeppelin fanatic, and AC/DC, and the Rolling Stones, and Pink Floyd, and all of that. That's what I grew up listening to. And when I got to, you know, when I was later in high school, and even when I was in college, and I started playing a lot of jazz music, you know, I would play it by looking at, you know, my association with jazz music or any other style of music was looking at a piece of music, a piece of sheet music, like a big band chart, you know? And so, and that's the way I tried to learn that music. And it never worked. And it took me a while to realize that it never worked because, you know, I wasn't learning it the same way that I would learn how to play Stairway to Heaven. When you go to play that with a band, you know, nobody, you don't say, they say, you want to play Stairway to Heaven? Well, I don't know it, but do you have a chart on it? That sounds ridiculous, right? But everybody knows the intro fill when the drums come in, and, you know, why? Because you've all listened to it. That's why. And so I made a pact with myself at that time that I would not play or perform any music that had some sort of history to it that I haven't gone back and done my homework and listened to and checked it out. So, you know, if there was a tune that I didn't know that came up like at a jam session, I would write it down and I would go learn it, you know. If I knew that we were going to perform stuff with a big band that had some history to it, whether it's Duke Ellington's music or Stan Kenton's music or whatever, I would always go find the original recordings, and I would check out who the musicians were on those recordings. You know, make a note of that. Oh, okay, all right, that's Sam Woodyard playing drums. That's what he sounds like, okay. And I would just try to imitate it, the same way I would imitate the way John Bonham or Charlie Watts or Phil Rudd, you know, played in those other bands that I mentioned. You know, and so once I started doing that, I realized I had a deeper connection to the music, and other people started recognizing it too, because they wanted me to play with them more, you know, and I felt like I had much better understanding of music, you know, and so it started the process of sort of giving my music some depth, you know, and that's one thing that we all need to do, is that we all have to give our music, you have to give your opportunity, yourself the opportunity to discover who you are through creating depth. And the way that you do that is by doing your homework. And one of the things that I see in my own students, and I see with just, you know, the one of the challenges of your generation is everybody, everybody wants something really fast. You know, everybody wants to learn how to play bass on YouTube in 5 minutes. You know, or wants to learn, if you can't show me on YouTube in 2 minutes, it probably isn't worth doing. But there's certain things that have to be done in real time. Real time. That means that if you are learning a song and you are trying to get to the crux of what that song is, you know, and that song is 5 minutes long, well, you're going to have to listen to that for 5 minutes. That's only one time that you've listened to that song, 5 minutes. You know, I can think of tunes that I listen to over and over and over and over and over again, and that just takes time. So you got to be patient. You got to give yourself a chance, you know, to learn, and it takes time. One of the key things that I see in all people that are experiencing some longevity in their career, and that's the key, you know. It's one thing to make a living when you're 20 years old, but how are you going to be making your living as a musician when you're 60 years old? You know, it's kind of a young person's game, you know. It's much easier to make a living when you're in your 20s, you know. But think about how you're going to make your living when you're 60s, or who is making their living in their 60s, you know. So creating this sense of depth basically takes time. And it takes getting experience. And college gave me that too. It gave me a lot of experiences, and it gave me a lot of opportunities to fail. And you know what? I sucked pretty bad. A lot. And you know what? You will too. But you might as well start right now. Start today. You know, because we all got a certain amount of suckage that we got to get out of our system. You know, you have to allow yourself to fail. That's part of learning, is failure, you know. And that's another thing that you have to keep in mind. You know, that does not mean that you're doing something wrong. That means that you're doing something right. So the question is, are you going to persevere even though you fail? If you really want to do it, nothing's going to stop you from doing it. You know, I mean, the music business is in a crazy state. But you know what? I see a lot of people that are figuring it out, being successful, doing what they do. A lot of that has to do with their work ethic. You know, how bad do you want to do it? It's not easy. You know, it takes it takes a lot of desire. That's what it does. I just produced a project that I played on, recorded in Nashville with a great young engineer. His name's Derek Gardner. It's the first time that I worked with him. And I tell you what, and he's a young cat. You know, I guess Derek may be in his late 20s now, maybe early 30s. And, you know, the kind of project that it was a jazz record that we were recording, which he doesn't really normally do. And so, you know, the thing that impressed me so much about him is, I knew that that wasn't the kind of project that he did normally, you know, but this cat, like, by the time I came to mix, like, had really done his homework. Like, I was really impressed because he had taken, like, you know, 5 of the most popular jazz records of, like, this year, and he's taken, like, 5 of kind of some historically significant jazz records, and basically had studied those recordings and, you know, use that as a way to kind of approach how he was going to deal with levels and compression and that sort of thing, you know. And, man, he did an incredible job. And you know what? I will use this cat, you know, for a lot of other stuff, you know. But because I'm really impressed that he took the time to do that, you know. And he's got great ears. And you know why he's got great ears? It's because he's just spent time doing it. You know, he's like, listen to the same thing over and over again. People ask me, how can you listen to something, hear something, you know, on a recording, and then just sit down at the drums and play it, you know? Well, because music is just, it's a language, you know? And I have heard certain things like that Max Roach plays, or Steve Ferrone, or John Bonham, or whatever. And so when you hear that, and you listen to it enough, you know, that translates to your instrument, you know? And so that's part of that development of your ears. Any questions about some of that stuff? Those are some very important, I mean, dealing with those things in college, I can't stress how much I learned in college, I guess is the long and short of, you know. And you guys have great opportunities here playing in these groups, you know. So, you know, I encourage you to kind of hold each other accountable. You know, if I wasn't taking care of business in my group, there was always somebody to let me know, hey man, this ain't happening. And another way to do that is to record your group all the time. Record every rehearsal. You know, for any of you that are performing, whether you're a vocalist or instrumentalist or whatever, you record every time that you do a rehearsal. It's so easy to do now. I still am old school, I guess, and use the actual recorder to do it. But, you know, now you use your phone or whatever. And then go back and listen to that. And when you go back and listen to it, it's going to be painful at first. It's going to be painful. Because you're going to hear a lot of the, you know, flaws and stuff like that. But that's the first step in getting better, right? You know, I remember some of the first things that I've recorded, and I would listen back in the studio, and I'd be like, oh man, look, my time is all over the place. It's like painful, you know. It's like, oh, I wonder if they can tell that I'm rushing terribly, or I wonder, you know. And of course they could, you know, but that was kind of my first step in saying, well, I got a smile about it, and you know, now I know what I need to work on. You know, we all need to work on something. Composition is it's one of the things that we still have a lot of control over, performance-wise. You know, as a side man, you know, playing on people's recordings and stuff. I mean, it's kind of sad, but you know, we're one payment and done, kind of. That's how it worked, at least in this country. You know, I thought, well, how could somebody just play on somebody's record and get paid for the session, even if they got double scale, or triple scale, you know? That's not very much considering how much the record sold, but that's kind of how the music business is, you know? A word that's become more and more important to me is mentorship. You know, and so one of the things that I wish I would have done when I was younger is I wish I would have been more proactive about seeking out the musicians and artists and people that were doing exactly what it is that I wanted to be doing. And I think I was a little bit too shy about doing that when I was young. It's become really important to me to stress now how important that is to find some mentors. It's not going to just be one person. But find people that are doing what it is that you think that you want to be doing. And then in the most polite and kind way, because that's very important in what we do, is being very polite and being very kind and respectful. Seek them out and try to get a little bit of their time. Whether you offer to take them to lunch, pay for it, by the way, you know, or take them out to dinner. If it's somebody that's performing around a lot, make sure that they see that you're at their gigs all the time. You know, it's one thing to say, hey, you know, man, you're really, really great, you know, and this person never sees you at any of their gigs that they're doing, you know. That person's probably not going to be as willing to share their time with you than seeing somebody that shows up all the time, right? So that just means that you got to be interested, you know. Most people, it's just a matter of showing interest, you know. I always thought, you know what, that guy or gal, they don't want to have any, you know, they don't care nothing about me. They're not going to want to hear answer any questions that I have. And I found out that, you know, if you show some interest in them and it's very genuine, people will slowly open up to you, and musicians and artists are very warm people, you know. I mean, when I moved to Nashville, I would meet somebody like that was a hero of mine, and the next thing I know, they were inviting me over to their house for dinner, you know. I was like, what? How does this work, you know? But they're good folks, you know. So offer to take them to dinner. And then maybe you can start to get a little bit more invasive about certain things, asking them questions about things, you know. I mean, I asked, you know, I like that, and I don't mind sharing those things. You know, if somebody says, well, what do you do with your money? Do you invest any of your money? What do you do? Have you invested some of your money? I'm happy to talk about that stuff. How much do you make? That's always, like, been this big secretive thing, you know. I don't want it to be that way, you know. I think people should know, and you should do some research on that, you know. So I encourage all of you to go and check out, you know, if you want to live in a town like Nashville, go to AFM 257, American Federation of Musicians, you know. That's the musicians union there. That you know, if you want to be doing things on a professional level, you know, you need to be a part of the musicians union. Or, you know, SAG-AFTRA, those are really important organizations, you know. That's the reason that there's any baseline or minimum to any amount of money. And if you have any problem getting paid, they will go and help you track down your money, which they have done for me several times. Yes?
I was wondering, like, when you were just starting out with music and, like, starting your musical path, like, what you would tell yourself to persevere, just because, like, society a lot of the time doesn't support the arts, and you get a lot of people who question you, I guess.
Yeah. Huh. What would I tell myself to persevere? Well, I mean, I've had times in my life where, you know, I didn't think that, I did my best, or, you know, or I've gotten fired off of a gig, you know, or something, and which is, that's normal. That means that I'm normal, by the way. That just happens in what we do, you know. But I think at the time, you know, we're all human, and we're going to be kind of hurt by that, you know. But I've realized, you know, as I've gotten older, that, you know, there's nobody going to stop me from playing the drums, or nobody's going to stop me from being a musician. You know, this is what I'm on this planet to do. I've been doing it my whole life. You know, music has brought me more joy than anything I can tell you. You know, I have, you know, pictures of listening to Buck Owens records, you know, when I was just a couple years old, and I would listen to the same record over and over again, all kinds of stuff. And so I thought, you know, there's no way that I'm going to let somebody take my joy from me. You know what I mean? So, you know, I can have a bad experience, or somebody can say, you know what, Jim, you're the worst drummer I ever heard in my life. Well, does that mean I want to go sell my stuff? No, because this is my music. You know, this is what I do. And so I think that, you know, we all have to have that. Now, having said that, I think that that love has to be there to where you truly want to be the best person that you can be, which means that you are willing to be patient and put in that real-time work. 1 minute equals 1 minute. Not, let me try to do this in a half a minute, when it really takes a minute to listen to it. Does that make sense?
No, yeah, thank you.
Yeah, sure. It's good questions.
So, when you were in the developmental stages, kind of, I guess, the college age of building your skill set and stuff, how did you go about replacing bad workflow habits with good ones, like procrastination and binge work before a rehearsal or writing or, you know, planning for a session? Like, what were some of the strategies you used to build a more functional and consistent workflow for yourself?
Oh, that's a really good question. You know, I would try to music. And I would always try to give myself the best opportunity to learn it. So if I was having to, like, learn a show, like, for instance, I remember starting with Alison Krauss, and it was like, you know, I knew that I was going to be doing the tour, and I've been waiting from their management to kind of hear what the music to learn, nothing. Okay, and then management has me come by and then take, like, 20 CDs, you know, well, here, you know, learn this, you know. And so then it's like literally like 2 days before we're about to start rehearsals, I didn't know what we were going to do, hadn't heard anything. So then I started to just go through every one of those recordings, and I said, well, let me just start with all the tunes that have drums on, because a lot of them, you know, the Union Station is like bluegrass oriented music. So, which I didn't know anything about either, you know. But so I went through that and started making charts for all the tunes. And I had learned how to make charts really, really quickly by taking opportunities to go and sub for people on bands, whether it's cover bands or whatever, you know. There was a time when I just did not say no to any gig. And so somebody said, well, can you sub for me? Yeah, sure, I'll sub for you. Okay, well, great. Well, learn, you know, learn these 30 tunes by tomorrow. Okay, man, okay, how am I going to do that? And I'm a drummer, and I got to know all the tempos, and I got to count everybody off and make all the transitions, you know. So I learned from this great drummer, Greg Bissonette, who's actually in town years ago. He came to our school, and he talked about getting these big note cards. You guys even know what those are anymore?
Yes.
Note cards, yeah. Well, you get the big note cards. And then, so he showed me this shorthand for basically writing out and creating charts. And so, and that way you can look, you know, basically in a short amount of time, you go through, you listen for big picture things, the form, what's the, you know, song structure or the tone, you know, verse, chorus, you know, bridge, whatever, notating the different grooves for each section, and then finding the tempo, putting the tempo marking in there. And that's what I did with her music. I went through it, and it was very complex, actually. It was like, you know, everything was different. Every verse and, you know, the obligatory 2-4 bar here and all kinds of stuff. But anyways, I went through and I did that. So that by the time I went to their rehearsal and they started wanting to sort of pick tunes and run tunes to do, I wasn't just totally out to lunch, you know. So all that to say is, you know, I like to get the music as early as I can to prepare for it. And then what I'll do is I'll listen to it as much as possible. So I'll put it in a playlist, and then we'll, you know, put it and have it running in my car, you know, or whatever. Try to learn it as much as I can up here, and then if I do have an opportunity to, if they don't send me any sheet music and I have an opportunity to make a chart, I'll make something that is, you know, that I'll be able to use. For instance, I'm playing like a couple of concerts at this gin thing. So one of them is a big band thing. It's on. I've already recorded I did the record for the big band, but I never play that music, you know. So, you know, I got my charts out that were marked up my way, not just what was given to me by the composer, you know. Because I'll get the drum part, and then I'll usually ask for a copy of the score. And if it's never been played before or recorded before, I'll ask for a recording of the MIDI file, so that I can just hear the orchestration. And then that way I can go in and I can edit the drum part and figure out the best way that I hear things should be orchestrated. So, you know, that way it helps get a better performance when we go in to record. And I know in my ear what's gonna happen, you know. Because I'd rather trust my ear than trust my eye. But I haven't played that music, so I take out an hour, you know, the past couple of days before I came down here, and I would play through the set of music just to make sure I knew what was going on with it, you know. Then I'm playing another thing Friday, it took me a while to get somebody to send me some recordings, but the recordings that he sent made the written music that he sent clearer, because there was a lot of stuff that wasn't in the written music that was on the recordings. You know what I'm saying? So I like to have as much time as possible to try to go through and prepare, because I feel like that's the only way that I can really do my best and then bring a bit of myself to the project. Because ultimately, you know, people are hiring you for who you are and what makes you unique, you know. And as long as this, you know, big band guy says, wow, I'd never even thought about that, and listen to the stuff that he's playing, you know, how does he come up with this, you know, whatever, that's great, because you know what, chances are he'll probably use me on his next project. And this whole business is about return business. It's like return business, you know. And then people hear you on another project, and then they say, wow, you know, I'm going to get that person, you know, beyond this. And then you start accumulating, you know, work and projects, and that, and you really start to build a career. Learning how to communicate is really, really important. You guys know who Baby Dodds is? Anybody ever heard of Baby Dodds? Baby Dodds is a drummer that's from New Orleans. He's probably the father of modern drumming, period. And he has a thing that you should all go listen to, that it's on YouTube now. He did this cat, Bill Russell did these great recordings with him in 1947, not too long before he passed away. I think it was 1947. And there's a segment called Playing for the Benefit of the Band. And it's 13 minutes of the most golden sage advice that you could ever hear. So if you, when you get on the YouTube, check out Playing for the Benefit of the Band, Baby Dodds. And he talks about playing for different, being able to accompany different people, and how psychology, it's very heavy, the stuff we talked about. I'm like, I'm always in tears by the time it gets to the end of it, because it's all the right stuff. And hear it coming from the guy who basically invented what we do. You know. So there's ways to make a situation better without it being harmful. But it's hard to change what's going on if you don't communicate in some way. So here's an example. Say, you know, if I'm playing with a bass player and it feels bad, and it feels like that the bass player is behind me, you know, well, we may stop or whatever, and I may look at the bass player and I say, hey, man, does it seem like I'm rushing to you?
You didn't put it on him.
No, that's right. I didn't put it on him or her.
Yeah.
You know? But, you know, anybody that, you know, is thinking for a minute might think, well, what, am I behind? You know, maybe I'm behind. You know, what's, you know? But generally, I want to know. I may be, you know, it's a, you know, the question may be obvious, may be not. But, you know, I've watched some of my great drumming heroes say that to other bass players, you know, I mean, and that's their way of being very kind, by saying, you know, you're dragging. If you can't talk about it, you know, then nothing's going to get fixed. And here's another thing, is expect somebody to always be asking you to change what it is you're doing. You know, that was something that I think was hard for me at the beginning when I did a lot of recording. Because somebody would always say, like, you know, a producer or something would say, like, you know, I thought I had, like, the perfect thing happening. And they would be like, you know, could you try this? You know, and inside I'm like, oh, no, that sucks. That's not going to be good, you know? And, but the thing is, I'm there to really realize what it is that they want. Instead of taking it personally, you know, just try to make them happy and try to do what they're asking, you know? And I realized that in many cases, it's the right decision, you know? I remember specifically doing a record with Crystal Gayle, and we would start playing, and we'd play through the tune, and I would come in, you know, from the beginning of the tune. And she would say, you know, say the tune would start off with a verse or something. And she would say, Jim, you know, don't come in. Don't come in until the second verse, you know. And I was like, oh, okay. You know, sure. But then I listen back to it and it's like, man, that's perfect. That's exactly what needed to happen, because otherwise there was no real build to what was going on, you know. That's all it needed, you know what I mean? So sometimes it's what you take away, you know. It's like equalization, you know. It's like EQ, you know. You want to do a lot more cutting than you want to do boosting in most cases, you know. We tend to want to, like, you know, raise things, but, you know, taking away is good. And I think of it as actually serving the other musicians that I'm playing with, too. You know, I want everybody to sound their absolute best, you know. So instead of playing with them and saying, you know what, I don't really like that person's playing, you know. So when they go to do their thing or they're singing or whatever, you know, I'm not going to, you know, I'm kind of, I'm not going to support them as well as I need to. That is no good. Nobody ever wants to hear any of that. And there's no space for that in what we do. You know what I mean? So no matter if you think that somebody's less experienced than you, then you somehow figure out a way to make them sound like $1 million. And if you can do that, you'll probably have $1 million in your pocket someday. You know, that's the way to be, you know, when we're playing this music. You know, it's not something that we fight with one another, you know. It's got to be unified, you know, at all levels, you know. So you always have something. You know, the thing that I learn over and over again is that we always can always learn something from every person or from every situation. If you're thinking otherwise, that's not true, you know. So even if it's a bad situation, think, what can I learn from this, you know. You know, like I said, you're going to have a lot of bad situations, and that's just part of it, you know. That means that you're progressing. Making a living and making music don't have anything to do with one another. I hope you all understand that. Figuring out how to make a living by playing music, that's a whole other thing. That's why you're here and you're in school, you know. So, like I said, I think I said, like, the music is mine, you know, that's my joy. And that's not something that I'm going to just give away to, you know, anybody. And so if, you know, if there's times that I don't feel, you know, not feeling great about what I do or what I'm doing or whatever, a lot of times I think it's because I haven't spent enough time maybe preparing the way that I need to. And I've noticed that if I really prepare for something, you know, and do the best that I can do, you know, that I usually will feel better about the situation, you know. It helps me feel better. You know, it's like that mirror test, you know what I mean? I want to be able to look myself in the mirror and say, you know what, all right, maybe that didn't go as good as I thought, but I did everything I possibly could to prepare, you know. And I don't want to look myself in the mirror and say, you know what, you didn't do the work. Because if you don't do the work, you can't expect good results, you know. But I promise you, if you do the work, everything is gonna be cool. I've seen it a million times. You know, it's gonna be okay. These are great questions. I didn't expect some of these. Yes?
I also had a small question about when you're writing music, like arrangements for things, you typically just sit behind a computer and go all MIDI for something like horn arrangements or drum parts, or do you prefer to have real instruments in the
Well, I rarely just have real instruments in the room and to say, like, hey, Paul, play this, and hey, Don, play this. But you know what? I rely on, you know, getting those people to tell me when things are messed up, you know. And it's you know, now that we have the computer, it's great because you can hear, you know, on the computer kind of a rendering of what it's going to sound like, you know. But then what you'll find out, you know, is you'll take it to your rehearsal with your crew, and then somebody's going to be like, oh, man, that's like off the horn, you know, or it's in the wrong octave. And so you're like, okay, and you know, and so at that point, they may say, say, well, why don't we voice the horns like this? And, you know, and then I can say, okay, well, that works, so let's do that. But initially, I usually just write certain things that, like at the piano, I don't even use a sequencer that much. But sometimes we'll use a sequencer, and then I'll have to, once I get kind of a mock-up of what I want it to be, then I'll take it and put it into finale or something like that, you know. And then usually there's adjustments that have to be made, from there, once you kind of, hear how everybody's playing and things like that. There's all kinds of musician jokes in between singers and, but there's nothing more that a musician respects than a vocalist. I'll tell you that. I mean, every great horn player, every great instrumentalist, all of their inspiration comes from the voice. That's just the truth, And so if anybody is, giving a hard time, they just wish that they could sing. It's good. I know I do. But having said that, a lot of that animosity comes from just a vocalist not being able to hold himself to the same standard that an instrumental musician might. And so when a vocalist comes in and is able to lead her gig and lead the band, that's like everybody just loves that. You know what I mean? So being able to communicate what you want, being able to count off a tune, that's not something that you want to be shy about. And that goes for everybody in the room. If you're going to play music, you got to learn to count off a tune, and the count off should give the subdivision of the tune as well. You guys know what I mean by that? Mm-hmm. Like, so if I'm counting off a, swinging tune, I would want to count something like this. One, two, three, four. By just adding that little swung eighth note in there, that gives all the information. If you can't come into time with that, I don't know what else I can give you, So being able to just confidently count off the tune, knowing what keys that you're singing in, so that they can accompany you best. Because there's nothing worse than a musician wants is to not feel like they're able to accompany you well. Because they want you to sound good and they want to sound good. So if you don't know what key that you sing certain things in, that it's going to be frustrating. If you are, picking the tunes, obviously, and being able to know, the styles of, and then also being able to know your responsibility for the music. Well, I guess we're out of time. That was a great question.